Now, when I was growing up, I had friends from all different types of backgrounds. And I mean, race was something that we never really talked about that often. But there would be times where someone would say a off the hook kind of comment or make a joke that I thought was pretty offensive or out of pocket. And it became very clear that their parents or whoever never really talked to them about race. And I mean, I understand. Race can be an uncomfortable topic to talk about. But with the police killings of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and countless other Black people over the years and decades, fired up protesters from all walks of life are leaning into that discomfort to speak out against police brutality and structural racism. And on the front lines of these protests are young people.
I'm here today because Black future in this country is in crisis. It has been in crisis for a long time. The fact that people are still being killed with impunity by this force that is supposed to be protecting and serving us is absolutely unacceptable.
There's things in this country that have been set up since the institution of slavery that make it hard for Black people to be able to live comfortably and freely without having some sort of resistance or feeling like their life is being threatened on a constant basis.
There's lack of accountability. People aren't, you know, being told what they're doing is wrong, and so it creates this ideology that what they're doing is okay, and that just perpetuates a system that puts everybody down, you know?
In the wake of these protests, the term anti-racism is popping up all over the place. There's TED Talks on anti-racism, books about anti-racism are hitting the top of the bestsellers list. Even late night comedians are trying to understand what exactly the term means.
You also talk about the difference between not racist and anti-racist. Can you differentiate that for me?
But anti-racism isn't a new word. It has a history and was used by civil rights movements throughout the 20th century. And now it's making a comeback. So today we're diving in and asking, what is anti-racism and what does it mean to be anti-racist? Before we tackle what anti-racism means, let's all get on the same page about what racism means. You've got in-your-face racism, where a person is prejudiced against another person because of the color of their skin. But it can also be more subtle, like not hiring someone because they have a Black-sounding name. But when that kind of prejudice gets baked into society, like it has in the US, you get structural or systemic racism, which is when a society is designed in a way that reinforces and perpetuates discrimination against certain races. You want an example? Oh, well, here's an example. Between 2012 and 2016, Black males convicted of a crime received sentences on average 19% longer than white males convicted of essentially the same crime. Perhaps Black offenders don't make as much money as white offenders, so they can't afford good lawyers. Maybe Black people get judges that hand down stricter sentences. Maybe it's both. But that's the point. Society's been structured in a way that hurts Black people harder. And it largely stems from one of the darkest stains on American history, slavery.
Systemic racism is really coming out of racial slavery. And ever since racial slavery in this country, Black people were not necessarily considered citizens.
That's Peniel Joseph, a professor at UT Austin who specializes in civil rights history.
And so ever since, even after the end of slavery, systemic racism meant that Black people were segregated to certain parts of cities, like in Austin, Texas, where I live, but that could be Oklahoma, it could be Los Angeles, New York. They had less access to land in the South, but they had less access to getting businesses in the North and everywhere. It means that they're treated differently by the criminal justice system, by police, basically in all walks of life.
You know, in our conversations that we have with young people, a lot of it made me feel like they view racism and all these issues as if they live in this like bubble of the past, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's like all those things you're talking about, like, oh, Black people couldn't go to certain places, they couldn't do certain things. And it's like people kind of go, well, like, you can now, so what's the problem?
I think part of what is so powerful as a historian is narrative. And I think the narrative that we've told ourselves is that, one, we don't talk about racial slavery. So that's taboo. So shh about racial slavery. The other is that there was a woman named Rosa Parks who was awesome, and she refused to sit on a segregated bus. And then you had Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who really was leading the March on Washington. But then he unfortunately was killed. But then you say Barack Obama was elected in 2008, and you have a Black president and a Black first lady, Michelle Obama, and you basically say that's the story of the civil rights movement in the United States, where there's a happy ending. We said we're post-racial, but then when we really look closer, we say we can see that we're really not post-racial. There's all these different things that are still unjust and unequal in our society, and this is connected to something much larger.
Rules or policies may appear race neutral, but in practice, they aren't. And that's true not just at the federal or state level, but at the local level too. Take school dress codes. It makes sense that schools don't want students to be distracted by revealing or inappropriate clothing, but the problem is what's considered distracting or inappropriate is really subjective and can end up reinforcing white norms. For example, do-rags, dreadlocks, and braids often get banned, which all affect Black students more. And when you look at the data around how school dress codes are enforced, that's what you see. Black girls end up being disciplined more harshly than their white peers. I know when I was in middle school and I had braids, I had to shave my head when I started at a new school. I don't know what that has to do with my learning capabilities, and I still don't know nearly 15 years later, but I did it. According to anti-racism, in order to address systemic racism, simply being not racist isn't enough. To quote Ibram X. Kendi, a historian and leading scholar of race and discriminatory policy in America, the opposite of racist isn't not racist, it is anti-racist, and that requires work. Emmanuel Acho, a sports analyst and former NFL player, went on Stephen Colbert and did a great job explaining this.
It's not enough in 2020 to be not racist. Not racist meaning I am passive when it comes to racism. That's what I mean by being anti-racist, Stephen. It's not just, okay, just because I don't say the N-word or just because I'm not scared of Black people. If you see it, you have to speak on it and call it out.
Anti-racism is an active state of mind. It's the active process of identifying and opposing racism.
Being anti-racist means also calling out racist policies in institutions and cultures that might not seem racist, but that are racist because they have a disparate impact on Black people.
Examples are everywhere. Voter ID laws that disenfranchise Black and brown voters, majority non-white school districts getting less money per student than districts with mostly white students, housing policies over the decades that have kept Black people in poorer communities with less homeownership.
When we think about racism, there's kind of no neutrality. It's either that you're trying to constantly oppose it, or you sort of fall victim to being part of a status quo because we live in a society where there is systemic racism.
In researching this episode, I did come across some opposition to anti-racism as a set of beliefs. I'm not talking about people who don't think racism exists or who don't think it's a big deal. I'm talking about people who recognize that systemic racism is a problem, but take issue with the either-or aspect that is at the center of the anti-racist philosophy. That you're either anti-racist or racist. There is no middle ground. So every conversation, every government policy is either explicitly working toward racial equality or it's actively working against it. This all or nothing approach has some critics comparing anti-racism to a religion, where any questioning of the philosophy is interpreted as an attack and can shut down questions and new ideas. Now, here at Above the Noise, we're not gonna tell you what to think. You gotta do that work and make up your own mind. However, if you're curious about what it takes to be anti-racist, here are some general steps. Step one is taking stock of any bias or prejudice that you may have and then challenging those thoughts. Personally, I've had well-intentioned white people say things to me like, "You're so well-spoken," or "You're so cultured." And in their minds, they're totally offering me a compliment, but it's definitely not a compliment. It's for sure an insult. But it's also important to understand that you don't have to be perfect to be anti-racist. I love this quote from Ijoma Oluwo, a Nigerian-American writer. "The beauty of anti-racism is that you don't have to pretend to be free of racism to be an anti-racist. Anti-racism is the commitment to fight racism wherever you find it, including in yourself, and it's the only way forward." Step two is educating yourself about how racism is systemic. It's about understanding what kinds of policies produce negative outcomes for people of color. We gave you some examples, so now you can't say you don't know what systemic racism is or that it's not a problem. And there are more examples to read up on and understand. Step three is taking action. At the individual level, that means speaking up when a friend says a racist joke or a family member uses a racist stereotype. In the moment, it can be easier to just stay silent and not rock the boat. But anti-racism demands you call it out and address it. At the structural level, it's thinking through how to dismantle racist policies to create new policies to help level the playing field. So, using the dress codes example we talked about earlier, maybe you educate teachers about stereotypes so they don't unfairly target Black girls. Maybe you ask students to write their own dress codes that reflect their values. Or maybe you just get rid of dress codes altogether.
It's a lifetime of work. And you can think of that as either good or bad, but you have to work on it. This is not something you do for one day or one week or one year. You have to keep it up and you have to bequeath that legacy to your children and grandchildren as well.
All right, folks, That's our dive into anti-racism. Now we want to hear from you. What are y'all already doing in your schools or in your communities to combat racism? Or what do you want to do? I can't wait to hear your answers. And before you go, let me tell you about a new PBS Digital Studios show that I think you're gonna love, Prideland. It's premiering on our brand new documentary channel, Voices. It explores LGBTQ plus life in the American South. Join host DeLon Burnside, AKA Ricky from the FX show Pose, as he recounts his own coming out experience and travels through the South to meet people breaking down barriers. Be sure to check it out, link in our description below. As always, I'm your host, Miles Best. Till next time, peace out.